Let me pray for us, and I have one announcement, and then we will begin. Father, thank you for a good day already. Thank you for caffeine. We know you invented it because it is a natural product, and this morning seems like a good morning for it sometimes. Thank you that you give us minds to think. Thank you that you give us hearts to feel. Thank you that you give us lives, material existence. You make us whole creatures, which even at the very beginning of creation, you called very good. Lord, we want to be holy, that is completely in pursuit of you. We want the whole of our lives to be Christ-like, not only our thinking, but also our action. We want to, in other words, love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and everything we've got. Use our time together, even in this session this morning, to that end, we pray through Jesus. Amen. Once again, I'll make the announcement. I made it before, but some of you may have not been in this session or may not have gotten it in another session. The Resource Center, that is the Grace Bible Church bookstore, which is also the Montana Bible College bookstore, is open during the breaks today. So if you haven't visited it yet, please feel free to go down there. I think Tasha has very capably been taking care of folks there. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask her or get her to help you. I do not have any notes, that is, explanatory notes for this session. The notes that are on the table are from session one. The notes on the chair are from session two, which are briefly just a couple of articles that help to summarize or explain session one and session two. So feel free, there's several there left, so feel free to grab some. If you weren't here for session one or session two and you wanted to kind of see what we talked about a little more, I know the notes are in your packet, but those are even more explanatory. But I do not have any notes for session three right now. All you have is the outline that is in your packets. So apologize for that. However, this should be a little bit easier session, I think. We'll be dealing with a little bit more familiar material, so hopefully won't be too difficult. I want to address one last issue. We've been discussing this morning in session one and session two some of the meaning of postmodernism, some of its implications, some of its effects, and how we understand it, how we respond to it. I want to address the influence of postmodernism in at least two areas as we come to some conclusion here today. We draw some finality. And in particular, the two areas where postmodernism seems most evident, that is, it rears its head most often, as well as most influential, is in the area of apologetics and in the area of politics. And I want to conclude our time together by asking, okay, well, what then does this mean for the church? But let's start out with the area of apologetics, which, if I can summarize or can safely encapsulate, I might describe apologetics today in a postmodern world this way. Apologetics is quite simply the struggle for truth. The struggle for truth. Not only truth that exists in ideas or statements, but the struggle for truth in existence as well. The struggle for truth in our very character. Because as we saw last session, truth is best defined not only by statements biblically or not only by statements in Scripture or ideas in Scripture. Truth is also defined in Scripture for us by the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus says, I am the truth. And the postmodern deconstruction or postmodern critique of the modern notion of truth only existing somewhere objectively or somewhere absolutely is rightly aimed so that it opens up a little bit further understanding of how can we make sense of Jesus' statement without appealing only to an idea. Because Jesus wasn't just an idea. He was a human. His incarnation matters. It should matter. It does matter for us to understand what it means to be the truth. And how we can, as Scripture depicts it for us, how we can be rightly understood to be of the truth or to walk in the truth. Apologetics is the struggle for truth. How do we verify knowledge and belief? I'm convinced that we must not turn to something outside of God to verify His existence or His word. This was done for many centuries. Proofs for His existence are merely an appeal to human reason. And what this accomplishes, really, I'm not convinced, is a helpful thing. I had Rene Descartes here on the screen for us in session one. And Descartes, in his Discourse on Method, one of the six tenets that he depicts for us in the Discourse on Method, the final one, was a brief proof for God's existence. He was so pressed after that by so many people that he wrote his Meditations on First Philosophy, which is six different proofs for God's existence. So in other words, he took the last part of the Discourse and Method and he expanded it to something much larger because people wanted this proof for God's existence. Now, if you read the book At the Origins of Modern Atheism, you'll find that, and I think the author is exactly right, you'll find that this is not only the beginning of what we would call theism, that is a belief that there is a God, and that God exists somewhere, perhaps out there, and He has certain characteristics about Him that our reason can determine. This is also the origin of modern atheism. Atheism looks the way it does, in part at least, if not even perhaps in whole, because of the proof of theism that Descartes concocted from human reason. We should not, must not, really turn to something outside of God to verify His existence or His word. Descartes, I had it out too. Would one of you guys do me a favor? Go to my office, and as you stand facing the back wall, in other words, facing away from my desk, you'll see about right here are all my philosophy books. Would you grab my Descartes Discourse on Method and Meditations on First Philosophy, please, James? Thank you. You sit there and look at it every Monday morning at 7 o'clock when we meet for discipleship. So. Descartes proved God's existence, well, he thought he had proved God's existence, by means of reason. But what do we have when we accomplish that? Do we have, in other words, let me ask the question this way, do we really have the God of the Bible? No, we have the God of human reason. And it may be a very attractive God. He may have some wonderful things about Him, philosophically speaking. But it's still a step across a fairly wide chasm to get to the God of Scripture. That's why I think what we see, especially in America, Michael's exactly right. We are a spiritual culture. We are a culture that still, though perhaps not as much as it did a few decades ago, that still believes in God. I think the last survey, it was somewhere around 89%, 88%, you would know better than I probably, of people in America believe in God. It's dwindling. A few decades ago, it was more like 94, 93, 95%, something like that. That many people believe in God. But don't be fooled. I'm here to tell you this morning, you who believe in Scripture, the authority of Scripture, you who believe that this is testifying to truth and that we can believe everything on every page is true because of our belief in the inspiration of Scripture, you who believe such things are a minority, a vast minority. You've already heard the term bantered about a little bit. I think Jim did it for us in his first session. I think you mentioned it as well, Michael. The moral majority of the 1970s with Jerry Falwell and his belief that he could ride the moral majority to a trip to the White House. He found out the hard way, we're really not a majority. Christians really are not a majority. Even though there are many who believe in God. Many who believe in God, the majority of our society. So Descartes was somewhat successful in this belief in God. But proofs for God's existence are merely an appeal to reason. Verifying God, in other words, by means other than himself, is idolatry. Verifying God by means other than himself is idolatry. In other words, what Descartes did was he was able to provide what seemed logical to the mind, some reasons that we could appeal to that ultimately decided the fact for us of whether or not God existed. And because he appealed to things outside of Scripture, what did the God of Descartes look like? It was the God of philosophy. It wasn't necessarily the God of Scripture. They're not necessarily the same thing. And though Descartes seemed to argue fairly strongly and fairly well that they were the same thing, nonetheless, the God of philosophy was born. And the God of philosophy, I want to tell you as strongly as I can this morning, the God of philosophy is an idol. It is a man-made creation. So when it comes to apologetics, I am convinced that we need not turn outside of Scripture. We need not turn to something other than Scripture. Now, James hasn't made it back yet, so he's obviously not familiar with my library anymore. That's okay. God has already verified himself. What I wanted James to find was a quote by Descartes so that I could show you I'm not making this stuff up. but there's a quote by Descartes in his Meditations on First Philosophy in the preface where he says that It's okay for theologians and people in the church to appeal to Scripture, but no one else in the world out there is going to be convinced by such circularity. Circular reasoning. And circular reasoning, according to Descartes, really, when it comes to philosophy, is a sin. You can't get away with it. And as Christians, we've come to agree. We've come to believe what Descartes has told us. Well, you can't appeal to Scripture because you're using Scripture. What do I mean by circularity? You're using Scripture to substantiate the existence of God, his character, what he tells us to be true. When God has given us, you also say, this Scripture. And it's this circle that there must be something outside of Scripture that we can appeal to that verifies Scripture and verifies the testimony that God has given. And as soon as we appeal to something outside of Scripture, I'm convinced Descartes' track, his path, was, though rightly intended, he really wanted to support the truth of, there you go, thank you, yes. You made it. It moves around. Yeah, thank you. Though rightly intended to support the truth of what the theologians were teaching, nonetheless, what he did was lead them astray and cause them to believe in a God that was really not their own. Yeah, Descartes says that, this is right at the beginning of his Meditations on First Philosophy, I have always thought that two issues, namely God and the soul, are chief among those that ought to be demonstrated with the aid of philosophy rather than theology. For although it suffices for us believers to believe by faith that the human soul does not die with the body and that God exists, certainly no unbelievers seem capable of being persuaded of any religion or even of almost any moral virtue until these two are first proven to them by natural reason. And since in this life greater rewards are often granted to vices than virtues, few would prefer what is right to what is useful if they neither feared God nor anticipated an afterlife. Granted, it is altogether true that we must believe in God's existence because it is taught in the Holy Scriptures, and conversely, that we must believe the Holy Scriptures because they have come from God. This is because, of course, since faith is a gift from God, the very same one who gives the grace that is necessary for believing the rest can also give the grace to believe that he exists. Nonetheless, this reasoning cannot be proposed to unbelievers because they would judge it to be circular. Descartes has thus removed from the equation the validity of God's own testimony. It's inadmissible because it's circular. I am here to tell you today that when it comes to apologetics, when it comes to the struggle for truth, we need not be embarrassed by the circularity. I'm afraid that's what has happened. We recognize that it's circular to use Scripture, and we're a little bit shy about it because people will immediately point to it and say, wait a minute, you can't do that. That's circular reasoning. Of course, others do it all the time. But when we say that there is absolute truth that exists, that there is truth that is for all, that doesn't seem to compute when it comes to circularity. The reliance on Scripture for us and the life of Jesus, we have to admit, has some relativity, some circularity within it. However, it remains an appeal to universal truth if God has spoken. Let me say that again. Our appeal to universal truth, that is, the universal nature of Jesus' claims, that is, the universal truth that God exists and that this testimony is given in Scripture that verifies his existence and his word for us, these are all true if God has spoken. We need not be embarrassed by the circularity. God's revelation is just that, his revelation. The fact that God has spoken means the relative nature of Scripture is raised beyond mere human circumstance or opinion. It is the truth for all time and all peoples in all places. This, God's word, is the absolute truth. Now, this is different from modernism in that I'm not trying to appeal to some truth that exists out there or some truth that exists apart from history. I'm appealing to a truth that is very history-laden. It is encumbered with history. It is only true because of the history that God has enacted to demonstrate his character or demonstrate himself. Our best apologetic is to speak and live the Scripture boldly. Boldly. It is the truth of God. We don't have to back away from that. We don't have to shy away from that. And we don't have to prove it either, as I'm going to explain here in just a moment. Yeah, go ahead, Chuck. Exactly, yes. It is a gift, dare I say. In fact, I'm going to talk about that in just a bit, the fact that time is really a gift to us because God is active in time. Go ahead, Dave. Could we not say in our defense, apologetically, It is, yes. You're exactly right. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Yeah, and really it only confirms the condition. He is a fool. Yeah. There you go. And if he has, then it changes everything. Yeah. The equation is different as a consequence of that. Go ahead, Ken. Yes, exactly. It is. And it is absolute in the sense that it is related to him. It's not objective in that it's removed from Scripture or something that's demonstrable empirically or something that reason can affirm necessarily. It is instead an affirmation of the fact that he upholds everything by his hand. Yeah, thank you for talking about that yesterday, Michael. That was fabulous. Other questions or thoughts about apologetics? Because I want to move to politics and power. This is where we're going to spend the bulk of our time now. In a sense, they're related, as we'll see here in just a moment. But when it comes to, yeah, go ahead, Tim.
Well, how would you suggest then practically engaging in our culture where they don't accept Scripture necessarily as a ground for truth? Just telling someone that it's true because God said it's true in the Bible, is that the way to go about it?
It's going to sound strange, isn't it? I mean, and I don't know that I would put it quite that way. And yet, in a sense, that's what we're doing. Because what we're saying is, you know, Scripture does have relevance to this situation. In other words, Scripture does have, what Scripture says does have some relevance to your condition and your question and your problem when it comes to evangelism. Now, even starting at the very beginning point, are we sinners? You know, does Scripture have anything to say about your life when it comes to sin or things that you've done wrong? Or how do we understand or explain that? There's a lot of anthropology discussed in here that's going to really, I think, open some doors for some people. Now, the problem, of course, is that our apologetic is usually aimed at convincing someone rather than convicting. And maybe that's the problem. Because Scripture will convict. The Spirit will convict. And as we're going to see here in just a moment with regard to politics, what I want to allow to happen is for the Spirit to be able to do his work. In other words, when truth impacts someone, I can't regenerate their heart. I can't change their mind. And I know you know this, Tim. So I'm preaching to the choir, but what I don't want to do is create a false dichotomy between the spirit and the mind. And I want the Spirit to allow, to be able to do his work. In other words, what I want to leave people with is if they have an argument with what I'm saying, let them always have their argument with Scripture. Why would I say that? Because the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, able to pierce to the level of joint and marrow, soul and spirit. The Word of God can do its work. I'm afraid I've kind of held it back and said, wait a minute, this guy has something to say, or this guy has some question that Scripture might not be able to speak to. So maybe I'm not making fun of you, Tim. Your question is the legitimate one. It's the one that everyone asks, but really? Do we just speak biblical truth to them? They're not going to like that. They're not going to listen to it. And perhaps you're right. Many won't listen to it. In fact, dare I say, Matthew 7, 13 and 14, most won't listen to it. But there'll be a few. The narrow way. There'll be a few who say, huh, that sounds kind of crazy, but yeah, so in other words, what I'm telling you is that you're going to have a big S on your chest maybe it's a JF on your freak, on your chest, that stands for Jesus Freak, because that's what we're going to be known as. That's that guy that just wants to talk about the Bible. And I've had that before. Sitting on campus, Lewis and Clark College, when I was college pastor in Vancouver, going to the campus and sitting there reading my Bible and talking to people about Scripture to do evangelism on campus. You get known as that's that Jesus freak guy. That's that Bible freak guy. He just wants to talk about Scripture. And then occasionally someone will come along who says, you're that guy that talks about Scripture, aren't you? Well, I've had this question, and maybe we can converse about that. It's not going to convince the masses. You're exactly right. But that's really not our goal. So excellent question, Tim. Thank you very much for being willing to sit there patiently while I dialogued with you without you saying anything. yes, Kirby.
There is one response, because if somebody wants to have a discussion with you and they don't want to look at the Scriptures, any intelligent pursuit of truth requires that we look at all the evidence. And that is probably the only resource that you can say. If you really want to pursue truth, we have to look at all the evidence, which means we can't exclude the Scriptures from the discussion.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and you've got to give the Holy Spirit something to work with. I mean, he can do whatever he wants, obviously. But I want to give him something to work with, which is the Word of God, living and active. Yes?
Maybe that could have answered it, but would there mm-hmm. never be a case where you would encourage someone to research more?
Sure.
I think of Joshua Dowell. Yeah,
yeah.
So, Scripture's included in that with archaeology, resurrection.
Right. My hope would be that eventually the question is going to come to, but what does the Bible say? So if Josh McDowell is helpful in that, by all means. However, what I want to be careful of is that I don't create a convert to Josh McDowell. And that's some of the danger in our apologetic, is if the evidence really convinces them, what happens when the evidence changes? If our science convinces someone, what happens when the science changes? And science obviously is changing and does change. And that's where I want to go next, is what's happening in somewhat in the scientific world and the political world. Other thoughts, questions? I'm going to leave this behind for a moment. The relationship hopefully will become clear to where we're going. Politics and power. Let me give you a definition of politics first. Politics is the power to persuade and move people to act. This is a very basic definition of politics. The power to persuade and to move people to act. Now, knowledge in relationship to politics had a fairly clear relationship for a long time. Knowledge in relationship to politics. Knowledge was a source for politics. Knowledge was an authority for politics. It still functions as an authority for politics, but in a very different way. You see, knowledge in the past, for instance, knowledge and politics, let's take the example of, let's say, the space race. Might be a very familiar and a wonderful example, because how did knowledge function in the space race? Knowledge was power. Knowledge really dictated, if you will, who was going to win. It was who could get the knowledge down first, who could get the knowledge right first, that was going to win the space race. And so the relationship between knowledge and the politics of the space race, the power of the space race, was a direct correlation. As soon as you got the knowledge and were able to enact it, then you were going to win. You were going to have the upper hand. However, knowledge has changed today, hasn't it? You see, even in the philosophy of science, there's a realization that all knowledge is biased and relative. Now, how does that impact science? Because science is still trying to reach for truth. Science is still trying to reach for reliable knowledge, but philosophers of science have recognized there's still a question that exists. Why are we pursuing this experiment as opposed to this one? It's a preference. In other words, there's a bias being exposed. It doesn't mean that knowledge is necessarily or inherently biased just because we've chosen this experiment over this experiment. However, as postmodernism tends to grow in its influence, even the knowledge that is presented by science, even the knowledge that is discovered by science, is seen as tainted or biased. And if all knowledge is biased and relative, then believability has more to do with personality than method. Let me say that again. If all knowledge is biased and relative, believability has more to do with personality than method. In other words, knowledge now functions as rhetoric rather than fact. Knowledge functions as rhetoric rather than fact. Now, I was telling the session earlier, I have occasion to interact here in Montana with the environmental community. It's a community that I love to interact with. I have several friends who are within the community, and they're believers, and I've led some Bible studies for environmentalists in the past. I've spoken at various groups and been part of Earth Day panels and things like that, which are a lot of fun. I mean, where else can you get invited to come and do evangelism? Really, I mean, it's a fabulous environment. Yet, I think environmentalism is perhaps one of the areas in which this notion is most clearly seen, that knowledge functions as rhetoric rather than fact. Environmental science is often anything but scientific. Some of you are smiling because you're familiar with this. Let's take, for instance, the wolf experiment. And don't misunderstand me. I have a theology for the wolf. God created the wolf. Is there a place for it in his creation? And should we, as those who are entrusted to have dominion, to exercise stewardship over the creation, should we care about the wolf? Yeah, I'm convinced we should. However, I'm not sure that's necessarily coordinate with the program that's in place right now for the support of wolves. The wolf experiment. What was some of the reasoning? Some of you can probably rehearse this for me as well as I can. What was some of the reasoning for reintroduction of the wolves here decade and a half ago, 2 decades ago? They were once here. Balance, yeah, I heard that. Balancing the ecosystem, returning to a sense of balance in the ecosystem. Yes, go ahead. They'll disappear, they'll go extinct. Exactly, yes. Of course, touching a wolf implies that we are still hunting them. Which I am in favor of, but Chuck.
Let me ask this. What is more important? Two great commandments, to love God and to love your neighbor as yourself. What is more important? Part of loving our neighbors, the people. So tell me what's important, protect the wolves or the cattle that feed the people?
Thank you, Chuck, for introducing perhaps the most inflammatory question of the day. Yeah, I'm not going to answer your question, but Graham. Not on the caribou. Yeah, yeah. It's a true story. There was actually an experiment with wolf populations and wolf existence in ecosystems that occurred prior to the reintroduction of wolves in the 1990s. Anybody familiar with what that experiment was called? It was called homesteading. If you're from some of these areas where the wolves have been reintroduced, you know they existed previously. And I remember very clearly some of the stories from my granddad, though I heard them through my dad, because my granddad died when my dad was only 12 years old. So my granddad homesteaded. They first appeared in the country. My grandfather and some of his cousins and brothers first came to Montana in the late 80s or so. In fact, I have a cousin who's buried in the Absorcas Cemetery. It's one of the oldest stones in the Absorcas Cemetery because he was shot during the Sheep and Cattle Wars. I think the date on the stone is 1889, something like that. And so I'm familiar with some of the nature of Montana. And my granddad used to say that, we really never had that many problems with the Indians. Usually when they would show up, my granddad and his brothers herded sheep. And usually when they would show up, we'd give them a couple of sheep and they'd move on their way. No conflict. He said the greatest trouble we had was wolves, because the wolves would come, usually at night, come through our herd of sheep, would kill fairly indiscriminately, and then just move on. And in fact, there was a story here just about 2 years ago, I think, of a flock of sheep in Dillon where the wolves came through, killed about 30 sheep or so. Fair-sized chunk of the herd, and then just moved on. It's not really necessarily balancing out the ecosystem when they seem to kill for sport, to maintain their instinct or their ability to kill. So did we have a wolf experiment before? Yeah, we did. It didn't work out too well, especially not for the wolf. It's happened before, and it's seemingly happening again. I don't know what the end of it's going to be. I do know that I want to maintain some place in my theology for the existence of all of God's creatures, but that also includes those that the wolves seem to prey on, and it's growing increasingly harder to do. But when it comes to, let's just use the one example of balancing the ecosystem, I'm not sure that all of the evidence was introduced. There was an experiment of how well the ecosystem was balanced when there were numerous wolves on the scene during the homesteading days. Perhaps, Graham, your story of them eating mice but killing caribou, I'm not sure I'd call that balance. In other words, perhaps there was a bit of rhetoric involved when it came to the science. And that rhetoric is being evaluated a little bit today. In other words, when it comes to I don't want anyone to answer this question, so it's a rhetorical question. You're all familiar with what that means. When it comes to the promises of environmentalists, are they as believable as they were back then? They made all kinds of promises. Well, we're only going to introduce wolves up to a certain level, 100 breeding pairs, and perhaps 300 total population. That's what we're after. But when that was achieved, what happened? Nothing changed. They were still a protected species. They were hunted, but not legally. So was there science rhetoric? That seems to be a real contentious issue especially right around here when it comes to reintroduction of the wolves. I don't know, maybe it's the snail darter, the spotted owl, yeah, in other regions of the country, but it's science becoming rhetoric. Now, how does this relate to politics? Well, what's interesting is politicians are perhaps some of the ones who are most aware of how science and knowledge function as rhetoric and are useful in convincing people of various things. I'm going to reveal a little bit about my age. Some of you will be confused about how old I seem, some of these guys over here, at how old I am, because others of you are going to look at me confused at, boy, how young I am. But the term spin doctor, what does that mean to you? To some of you, it means George Stephanopoulos. And you remember who he was, the spin doctor for the Clinton campaign. For others of you, you're thinking I'm talking about the musical group, the Spin Doctors. yeah? Now you just dated yourself there, Chuck. Yeah, these guys have no clue who you're talking about. Yeah, that's it. Spin Doctors is maybe another way of thinking of it. And Spin Doctors in politics, lest you think it's just a tool of the liberals, it was George W. Bush who was the first to maintain his campaign committee after he was elected. For generations in presidential elections, they would establish a campaign committee, and then once they were elected, what usually happened to that campaign committee? It was disbanded. They were often given jobs somewhere in the cabinet. And yet, George W. Bush, and he learned this really from Clinton, I think, but he was the first to maintain his campaign committee throughout his presidency. Why? Because he understood the importance of rhetoric. He understood the importance of knowledge being used appropriately. Now, I would say he didn't actually learn it from Bill Clinton. He may have some, because Bill Clinton understood it very well. But really, this began well before Bill Clinton. It began, dare I say, with the Vietnam War. Because in Vietnam, there was the discovery of how knowledge impacts people and public opinion. It was with the Vietnam War that rules or laws were tightened considerably about media outlet of certain pictures, certain ideas and statements. Remember, some of you may remember the cover of Life magazine with a young Vietnamese girl, running down the street naked because she'd just been hit with Agent Orange or napalm. And her skin was on fire, chemically on fire. That's a picture that Life magazine put on its cover. And was it impactful? Dare I say, almost to the point of civil war, civil unrest. Yeah, some of you lived through that, so you know exactly what I'm talking about. I was just an observer and a young one at that during that time. But rhetoric and knowledge. I need to bring this around now. The effect of this on the gospel is that now faith has more to do with what is believable, and believability has more to do with what do I see, what do I understand to be true. In other words, what brings me this feeling of contentment or pleasure rather than trusting in something outside myself for appeasement of my guilt and my shame. If knowledge is rhetoric and people know it as rhetoric, then really what's going to attract me is personality, feelings of trust. I can trust this person and this, not this person, because really I just like this person better. It was an amazing event that happened during the George Bush Sr. campaign for re-election. He lost to Bill Clinton. But only months prior to the election, George Bush Sr. had an approval rating of over 70%. The old adage that there's nothing wrong with America that a good war couldn't fix. The original Gulf War began. And right immediately after it began, George Bush Sr. had an approval rating of 70%. Bill Clinton saw that and knew that he had to come up with some way to spin it so that he could somehow deflate this public support. And what he did was come up with a slogan. Do you remember what it was? It's the economy, stupid. It's not about America as defender of justice, America as this coalition of the world's powers. It's the economy. It's about us, in other words. He had to somehow change the nature of the debate. And as a consequence, people liked him. He was pretty folksy, too, so he was an attractive feature. He looked a lot more appealing than George Bush Sr. People liked him and believed him, rather than believing George Bush Sr., even though George Bush Sr. perhaps had the track record, perhaps had the reasons for being supported. Now, I don't want to engage in a this party or that party kind of debate. All I'm trying to point out is that appeal or likability now has as much or more to do with what we believe than any external source. Even, dare I say, the source of Scripture. Our solution to this is at least twofold. There are certainly more things that we could mention, but the first one I want to mention is do not transform the gospel into entertainment or some psychological formula for the betterment of the self or society. In other words, if we try to make the gospel more likable, more appealing somehow, we are doomed to fail. I'm mindful here of a church that I'm familiar with, very familiar with. And at Michael Jackson's death, the church decided that it would be a good idea to do a sermon series on, like a 6-week sermon series on Michael Jackson's songs. And it, it was like, but this is a way to appeal to our culture. And I was, my response was, this is a way to defame the gospel, to deflate the gospel of its power. Now, that's not an opinion about Michael Jackson one way or the other, though I do have an opinion about Michael Jackson. But it's simply to draw attention to the fact that when we make an attempt to translate the gospel into something appealing to the culture, who is ultimately going to be changed? Not the culture. The gospel. In other words, if we make an attempt to appeal to the culture by making ourselves more likable, more appealing, we are the ones who've changed. We are the ones who are different. And ultimately, the gospel may suffer the price, may pay the cost. And people are being won to false gospels, I'm afraid, every day. Instead of doing this, I coming back to Tim's wonderful questions, I love having you here. Why don't you stay and go to school? You've already been to school probably too long. But instead, what we need to do is to allow the Holy Spirit to accomplish what he is prepared to do. He will convict of sin. He will regenerate. He will convert. He will transform lives. Any program or strategy that attempts to replace the Holy Spirit with social reform or an entertaining personality is ultimately going to be a fraud. We need to allow the Holy Spirit to do his work. And what's he going to use to do his work? The Word of God, ultimately. The Word of God. That's why I love teaching at a Bible college. When I first showed up, people would love to have me as part of, perhaps it's because I wear the bow ties, I think. I wore this today for you, Michael. I had to tuck in my shirt and put on the tie, and I thought, okay, you said something about being eclectic yesterday, and we, yeah. I wear this for the students, too, yeah. It's mostly to just to keep them awake, I think. But where was I? I got offered a job at MSU because of being at Duke with Howard Wass. And I don't want to teach at MSU. I'd get fired probably the first or second day. Why? Because this is what I teach. I love teaching at a Bible college. I love teaching the Scripture. Now, that doesn't mean that we are a cloister, that we're an ivory tower of some sort. No, I have my students going out and doing things on campus at MSU, on the streets of Bozeman all the time. And they love it, don't they? Yeah, it's a good time. Yeah. Any program or strategy that attempts to replace the Holy Spirit with social reform or an entertaining personality is a fraud. The gospel is not just rhetoric. And I'm convinced that the reform is us. In other words, the greatest apologetic that we have is us. And that is by design. Have you ever thought to yourself, why is it that God doesn't, when he saves us, just immediately take us to heaven? Wouldn't that be so much better, it seems? Wouldn't it be so much easier, it seems? He leaves us here in these decaying bodies, and I find out every Monday, Wednesday, Friday just how much more mine is decaying. That's the days I get to play basketball with the young guys here at the church. And God leaves us here rather than take us home immediately. God, what are you doing? God, why are you doing this? And instead of thinking about time as a burden, as God leaving us here, what if we thought of time as a gift? As a wondrous gift, that God has given us time precisely because his glory is public. Precisely because he wants his glory to be extended to the ends of the earth. And it's going to take time to do that. And it's going to take us to do that. It's going to take us living the gospel each and every day before a watching world, a world that may hate us. The postmoderns aren't going to love us. Though what I'm using, in a sense, is their theory of truth. It's ours, too. The greatest apologetic is us. That's precisely because you've heard the old adage, imitation is the greatest form of flattery. I've changed that, haven't I, guys? Yeah. It's an old adage for you now, Dirk, because you've heard it so many times. I want to change that to imitation is the greatest form of glory. Imitation is the greatest form of glory. Why? Because we're left on this earth. We are given time as a gift precisely because we are predestined to be conformed to his image. That's why God is at work in our lives, conforming us to the image of Christ, transforming us into the life of Christ so that we can be the truth and be the expression of His glory, His grace, His greatness to this world. The greatest thing we can do for the world, and I learned this from Stan, is be the church. Be who we were meant to be. That's the best thing we can do for the world. Not to serve the world by contributing to social justice. Not that that's bad. We should engage in those things. However, the best thing we can give the world is the church. Because it's only in the church that the world is going to know that it's in need of redemption. It's only if we live as a people who believe in sin and redemption and forgiveness and transformation into the life of Christ through the Holy Spirit that they're going to know that they're lost and in need of conversion. We are God's expression of the gospel. We are not the gospel, but we are God's ambassadors of reconciliation, as Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And I'll leave you with this. We're all familiar with 2 Corinthians 5, 17. Therefore, if any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. Behold, the old has passed away. New things have come. Now all these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Namely, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. And he has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were entreating through us. We beg you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. Ambassadors of reconciliation. Through the words that we speak the scripture, we speak the truth. Also through the lives that we live. We live the gospel. We live the life of Christ so that others may see the truth and become the truth themselves. Would you pray with me, please, as we come to a close? Father, you are so good and so gracious to bear with us in time. Peter tells us in 2 Peter 3 that a day is as 1,000 years and 1,000 years as one day. You are not slow in your judgment, in other words. But Lord, thank you that you have postponed it. Thank you that you patiently, painstakingly at times, work with us, your people. We are so like children, oftentimes distracted by the things that are shiny, the things that are fun and entertaining. But Lord, we pray, as dangerous as this prayer is, mature us. Cause us to walk in your truth so that we might be the people of Hebrews 5, 14. People for whom solid food is meant. As the author says, solid food is for the mature who because of training, because of practice, have their senses trained to discern good and evil. Mature us. Make us more into the image of Christ that we might be your truth and be your truth for a world who needs to see the truth. Thank you, Lord, for conferences like this where we can gather and discuss heady issues. And as we head home to worlds that may be small or rural, worlds that may be metropolitan, may we see how your truth, your word, and the life of Jesus make a difference for the lives around us. We pray that through Jesus, our Lord, our Maker, our Redeemer, the anchor of our souls. Amen.